As I think back, I can put my life into a few stages. And the stage that I like to talk about is probably the time I was 20 to 40, and a time where I have somewhat of an addictive personality, and that when I'm talking about every part of my life, and the problem with that is that I started drinking. And unfortunately, that addictive personality led to sort of my downfall. People looked at me on the outside as somebody that was very carefree and very jovial and always having fun and a good time. Inside, though, I was killing myself. And I didn't know it at the time. And I was killing everybody around me too. And that led to demise in my first marriage. And I was married to a woman that loved me. And I didn't know how to accept that love because I didn't know how to love. And I hid behind the alcohol and the drugs. And it was an escape for me. And I just carried on my daily life. I was a teacher. I was a friend to a lot of people. I thought I was a father at the time. And it was just a downhill slide. And I lost my first marriage. I lost two kids at that time. And I was so far down that I didn't realize what I was doing until it was too late. And it was a wake-up call for me. And I couldn't have been any lower at that time. I thought I couldn't be any lower at that time. I thought I'd hit rock bottom. And I knew I had to change my life. In order to have any relationship with my children at all, I knew I had to change my life. And I stopped drinking. And at that time, I thought it was something monumental. To a certain degree, it was monumental. Yet I figured that was my last hurrah as far as being down in the dumps, and now I was starting to pull myself up. And I figured by stopping drinking and drugs that would be the final curtain for me, that I'll be back in the game and back rolling again. And so that's what happened. I had to start a relationship with my kids again, and I got remarried. And then shortly after that came part two of this story, but let's just go with the song and then we'll come back.
Running hard and running scared, somehow I just didn't care back when I was drinking. And all the crazy things I do, crossing lines and breaking rules, mixing pride and attitude back when I was drinking. I found it easy to deny all the hurts and all the dreamed of asking why back when I was drinking. 10 feet tall and 80 proof, always playing fast and loose with my life and with the truth back when I was drinking. You
20 years somehow since I threw that last one down. I was lost, but I've been found now that I'm not drinking. And I can thank my lucky stars that I'm sober and you are with me, and we got this far now that I'm not drinking. And I can thank my lucky stars that I'm sober and you are with me, and we got this far now that I'm not drinking. Now that I'm not drinking. Now that I'm not drinking. So coming to the second stage of my life that I've been talking about, I figured at this time that I had quit drinking, and I had stopped my drug usage, and I figured that all was well. The problem at this time was that I still, my ladder of life, I was still on top, and I really cared about myself more than anybody else. At this time I was also remarried, so I put in myself first, maybe my wife second, my kids third, and whatever else at the bottom. It really didn't matter because I was still the top rung. And this posed a problem because I was, being at the top of this ladder, I was still, searching for something. And I didn't know at the time really what it was. I knew I still didn't know how to love. And I was married to another lady who loved me, who was showing me love. And it wasn't a reciprocal situation. I faked it well. But there was just something missing. And unfortunately, we come back again to the addictive personality. Not only does this deal with alcohol and drugs, but it also is part of my life as far as extramarital affairs. And I was still trying to grab onto something, and that was part of my past, where the extramarital affairs was one of those things that brought me down. But apparently, I wasn't down as far as I should have been. And November of '95, everything came crashing down. And I finally was as low as I could possibly go. So I'd already lost one marriage. I pretty much lost my children. And now I was about to lose a second marriage. And I didn't know what to do. And I just didn't know what to do. And in speaking with my wife, she had just been... She'd been for a walk up to the top of this hill. And when she got to the top of this hill, there was a voice that told her, that he's in charge, not me, but the Lord is in charge. And it said, no matter what you do, I'm in charge and nothing else matters. And she came down from that mountaintop after what I had done to her, after I had totally destroyed the faith she had in me. And she said to me that, I'm not going to give up on you, but you're going to have to change your life because I'm not going to be here any longer if you keep doing what you're doing. And at that time, I asked the Lord to come into my heart. And it seems like such a simple thing. But to me, it was in an instant, literally in an instant, my life changed. And it was like this huge burden, this huge load just completely fell off my back. And I don't know any other way to explain it. Maybe with some people, when they accept the Lord in their life, that it's a long conversion process. With me, it wasn't. It was instantaneous. And I'll never forget that feeling, that all the scales just completely came off. And I was wide open. And I realized that where I was on that ladder, being on the rung, on that top rung, now I was down below someplace. I don't know where I was. But my wife, the Lord was first, my wife was second, my kids were third, my job or whatever else was fourth, and I was down there. And the view from the bottom at that time was so refreshing because I had a new life. By giving my life to the Lord, He's my Redeemer, and I'm not accountable to anybody anymore except to Him. And that freedom that I experienced, not worrying about things anymore. I don't get bothered by things ever since 1995. I just don't get bothered by things because I know that my faith in the Lord is paramount. And I know He's going to take care of me no matter what happens. My faith is in Him. It's that blind faith that is so strong. And that's where I am right now. And I live my life for Him. And ever since 1995, our relationship, my wife and my relationship, has never been better. And my relationship with other people, especially Mark Pearson, has never been better because of that night. And to me, it was a life-changing experience, and I thank God for that evening.
Comes down to one moment, fall of 95. By her tears I could see clearly, I simply had to change my life. It was on a dark and rainy night that I got down on my knees. Said if you were up there, Lord, if you can hear me, please, I can't make it on my own. I can't make it all alone. I need you, Lord, I need you, Lord. Oh, how for so long I thought that being a man meant being in control. But when all was lost that night, I knew I must let go. As I held my breath and closed my eyes, all I could think to say, Lord, I hope you catch me as I make my leap of faith.
I can make it on my own. I can make it all alone. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. Oh, how I need you. And now I have a conversation with a good Lord every day. I offer him the reason that I gave my life away. I can make it on my own. I can make it all alone. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I can make it all alone. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. Oh, how I need you.